All right, so thank you very much for inviting me to this weird symposium or a different symposium. I'm very happy to share what we've been doing with the MNE software over the last few years. So I will present a few slides and then do a demo with interactive slides in Jupyter Notebook. If you want access to this, I gave you this link on the first that you can hopefully read, which is bit.ly/mne_sapien_labs. 2019. And if you click on this link, you will get a PDF of these slides, including the notebooks that you can run on your own machine. So let me start by what I want to tell you about during this 20-minute presentation. So the first is history and the vision behind the MNE software and specifically the MNE Python software. And then I'd like to highlight a few things that you can do with MNE Python. And then I'll do a live demo. And I've put again the URL that you can click on. All right, so let me start by just showing you the screenshot, which is the MNE website. That should be the entry point if you want to discover what MNE can do. This is just a static view. But if you go there, you will see that MNE can do a number of things, including reading of various file formats, as Cyril mentioned, including EDF and now also BIDS types of data. You can do, of course, a lot of pre-processing options. There's a lot of visualization tools. And especially as you can see on this slide, MNE has been built historically for source imaging. And what you see in the background is a brain with an activation in the auditory cortex. So let me start by explaining what MNE is building on. So I started to write MNE in 2010 when I was a postdoc at Massachusetts General Hospital, MGH, in the Martino Center. And so I was already experienced writing Python code, and I said there was a missing part, which is be able to process EEG and MEG data in Python. So Python is a fairly rich ecosystem, and so MNE builds on this ecosystem. So what you see at the bottom is just the Python language. And then you have a number of tools that go on top of it. So you have NumPy, which is to do basically manipulate matrices, tensors, basically arrays of numbers. You have what is on your left is IPython, which is an interactive shell that I will demo afterwards. Something that you may have heard of, which is called Jupyter, and especially the notebooks, which are becoming extremely popular in, say, science and data science, especially. And then on top of these building blocks, you have the more scientific stack. So SciPy is the scientific Python library, which has a number of things to do, again, the linear algebra, optimization, signal processing, image processing, and a number of other things. Matplotlib is what we use for visualization, and Pandas is for the R users, if there's among you. It's basically a data frame for Python. And what you see on the left, so in blue and orange, is scikit-learn. This is a software that I also have been writing since 10 years, and which allows you to do machine learning and unsupervised learning, and supervised learning meaning what people would call in MEG and EEG decoding. Basically being able to predict, for example, what the subject is experiencing, what is the stimuli given the activation inside the brain. And so MNE is really built on top of this ecosystem and is really bringing EEG and MEG processing to this ecosystem. So MNE Python is really developed in an open way. So historically, as it started on GitHub already in 2010, so very early, and it's a fairly rich project, rich in its number of contributors. So as you can see, you have about almost 170 people, different people who have contributed to the project since the beginning. It's used by 220 other projects on GitHub. It has more than 500 people who have forked and made their own modifications to the project for their own needs, and almost 1,000 people who are watching the project, so starting the project, and some of them are watching the project to follow what's going on every day. In terms of license, also MNE is the license in BSD3, which is very permissive license, which is very common in the Python ecosystem. And one of the benefits of this license is that it can be used for commercial applications. So MNE really did not start in 2010. So Cyril was quite specific by mentioning MNE Python. The reason is that MNE is much older than this. So MNE was started by Matti Hämäläinen, that you can see on the upper right corner of the slide. So Matti Hämäläinen is professor at Harvard, and he started to write the MNE C code when he arrived at the Martino Center in 2001. So he wrote the MNE C code, which has a number of GUIs and allowed very early on to do source imaging on top of FreeSurfer. And the MNE Python is really what I started as a postdoc now in 2010. So just to give you numbers, this is number of commits, the number of people who have contributed. It's evaluated to a fairly large human effort of almost 30 years if it were to be done from scratch. You see that he has a steady growth in the number of commits and lines of code, and so far it's been a quite sustainable project. So MNE Python is written in pure Python, has no compile code, which means that if you have a Python interpreter, you don't need any compiler to use it. So if you're a MATLAB user, it means that there's no MEX files or equivalent of MEX files. Everything is completely interpreted. Again, it's BSD license, which means that there are some startups and some companies that are using MNE Python internally. And since there's no compile code, it's really easy to make it work on any platform, Mac, Linux, or Windows. And we have users and developers on these three platforms. So this is where MNE has been contributed in different places. So you see on the web page is all these logos of all the people who have invested a bit of their time and some of their grant money to contribute to MNE. And really, it started for me when I was in Harvard. There was so much expertise there. And I said, I was not coming from Harvard before my postdoc. And it's like, I really miss all the things that I learned in Harvard. And I said, many more people should be aware of this and should get access to these tips and tricks that makes good EEG and MEG data analysis. So I wanted to make this collaborative tool like scikit-learn was taking off in the same with the same vision. And so make this tool be able to be shared and documented and developed by a fairly large community, push it out of the walls of the Martinos, and really make sure that we can get the best of what people know how to do with EEG for the world. And there's been quite plenty of anecdotes like this, where people, for example, in Ulish, that have been very experienced MEG users, and they came up with very nice tricks for us to automate things on ICA. Yeah, and so many of these things. So the question you may wonder is, but what can you do with MNE? So if you go to this documentation that you see here, so you have the URL at the top, you have a list of topics that MNE covers. So I invite you to go to this webpage and click on the sections and explore from there. So just as a disclaimer, there's currently a huge ongoing effort to improve the MNE Python documentation to get people who are really new to this world of EEG and MEG get started by really entry-level concepts, where historically MNE Python was written by very experienced people that kind of neglected, to be honest, the jargon and all the intro stuff that should have been mentioned before diving into advanced concepts. So I'm hoping that for the next release, which should be in a few months, probably around the summer, we'll have a fully fleshed out documentation. So this is a few screenshots of types of figures that you can produce with MNE. So on the upper left is the boundary element model for forward modeling. On the top is how you would do group imaging using anatomical registration. On the right is the time frequency transform. And what you see at the bottom left is a connectivity graph. And in the middle is a source imaging using beamformer on a volumetric grid. And on the right is a DSPM, so MNE style reconstruction on the cortical surface. And all these figures are produced by MNE Python scripts. So MNE is built on top of FreeSurfer, which means that MNE Python that doesn't have any code that allow you to process MRIs or any types of anatomical information. All this is handled by FreeSurfer, and you don't have to be an expert in FreeSurfer to use this. Basically, the command that you see at the top, which is reconol dash the name of your subject. So for example, in bits, that could be sub underscore 001. And then dash I, you would provide the Nifty file or your DICOM file and let FreeSurfer run. And you will get a processed MRI like you see on this image, which is what MNE relies on to do all the source imaging. All right, so now I'm going to jump onto the notebooks. That again, so I give you the link again. And so let me exit this, and I'm going to move to this live slide deck. And so we'll be playing with MNE Python. So here, just to show you that it's live demos, I can do print 1+1, and this will just execute. So I'm going to do the live demo of MNE in front of you. So this is just to avoid a few print messages that would be messy on the slide deck. But so let's see. All right, so what I'm going to do here is process what we call the MNE sample data, which is one of the public data sets that MNE has. So let me open this in a new tab. So here you see that MNE has a number of data sets that you can use. And all of these data sets are basically stored on osf.io, so open framework, which means that they are completely freely available. And if you run any of the code that uses a public dataset from MNE, it will just download it automatically from OSF. So if I just execute this line, if I don't have the data, I will download it. And for me, since I already have it, you see that it's going to take a FIF file. So this is what we have for the sample data, but MNE can read a number of other file formats that I'm going to just very quickly illustrate. You see that if you have different input types of data, so in, well, EEG would be brain vision, so VHDR, EDF, biosemi, GDF, neuroscan CNT, EGI, EEG lab, and all these things. And we have a bunch of reading functions for these different EEG and MEG formats. So here for the demo purposes, I'm just going to use FIF file, so this sample data set that contains, again, both MEG and EEG that were collected simultaneously. So I'm going to read my data here. So now I've got my raw objects in red. It has more than 300 sensors, so channels, and the corresponding time courses, which is roughly 6 minutes of data. Okay. So then you can filter your data. For example, like here, this is going to filter my data between 1 and 40 hertz. So end jobs is here set to 1, which means that the filtering is going to be done with only one CPU. But if you have a big machine, you can use you process more channels in parallel, and you can do parallel computing. All right, so now if I inspect a bit what you have in this raw instance, it has a number of what metadata, what we call the measurement info, that tell you what is inside this raw object. So you see that it has 60 EEG channels, it has one EOG channel, it has stimulation channels or marker channels, and here you also have MEG, so you have gradiometers and magnetometers. Everything is within the same object. You see that the data has been filtered between 1 hertz and 40 hertz that you see here. You see exactly when the data has been collected, so it was in 2002, and etc. All right. So here in the notebook, it's kind of hard to do a live demo of the viewer, but you can, of course, view your raw data. So this is just the viewer that you would see here, just showing six channels over a period of roughly, I think, a number of seconds. Yes. And what you see in light blue is the gradiometers, in dark blue is the magnetometers, and what you see in black is the EEG. Okay, and you see, for example, here the heartbeat that you can see quite well on these MEG channels. Okay, so one thing you could do is you could look at the power spectrum density of your data. So I can here compute it. I'm going to look at the power spectrum density of all my sensors between 1 and 45 hertz for the first 16 seconds. And what you see is every line here corresponds to one channel. And what you see here in small inset at upper right is basically the channels which are color-coded. So you see here that the channels, the EEG channel that are more frontal, tend to have a higher power between 25 and 40. And here what you can, for example, see in the magnetometers is that you seem to have a frequency artifact here around 32 hertz. Okay, so these types of plot PSD roots functions are super useful to spot artifacts that may occur within your data. This is not all, but it's a first thing to do when you open your data. It's something I do all the time. Okay, so this is just the raw data. Now, since these data are coming from an experimental paradigm where people had to either listen to auditory tone or experiencing visual flashes, so you had left auditory stimulation, right auditory stimulation, left visual or right visual. So here in this object, I don't have annotation. I have so-called a marker channel or stimulation channel. So I'm going to extract from this raw object the events that I can just so compute, and you see that in this trigger channel, I have a number of events, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 32, okay? And you see it will sample these events occur. And I'm going to use these events to compute my epochs. So in order to understand what my paradigm is about, I can use this mne.viz.plot events, and what you will see here is that I'm going to code the marker or trigger number one by saying that it's an auditory left stimulation, and number two is an auditory right, three is visual left, and four is visual right. Okay, so here this is just plotting this figure, and you see that you have a kind of random alternation between the different types of stimuli, and you see how many times each of these occurred. Okay, so now I know when the stimulation occurred, and I can construct my epochs. So this is what this code is doing. I'm going to extract epochs between 200 milliseconds before the steam onset to half a second after the steam onset, saying that I want to extract both MEG channels, both EEG channels, including the steam channels and the EOG. Here, I decimate just to speed up a bit the computation. I get my epochs, and I can basically see what's in it. You realize there's a parameter here, reject, that I'm not going to spend time on, which basically removes strong artifacts. And after this artifact rejection, this is the number of epochs that is still here. Okay, so now if you're wondering what's inside these epochs, basically these epochs is just a 3D array where you get 236 epochs over this number of channels and 211 time points. Okay, so let me move on. I want to show you how to compute now so-called evoke responses, or event-related field or event-related potentials if you do MEG. So here I'm just going to blindly average all my epochs, and this is going to give me the evoked response, where you see that this evoked is a mix of auditory left and everything. There's something quite neat you can do since this event ID I coded with a slash. You can see the slash as a way to separate between tags. I can say epoch square bracket left, and now this is going to take all the epochs that correspond to a left tag. So here auditory left will survive and visual left will survive. So here I'm going to do the same thing for now, and I'm going to take all the auditory respond, either they are left or right auditory, and this is going to give me an evoked object. So this evoked object, I can display it. So what you will see right here, so you see that you see the evoke response for the three different types of data, so the EEG or the MEG. And I can also look at the topography for the EEG, as you see here. So one thing which is quite specific to MNE, since it was really built at the beginning to support MEG from the start, we really have a strong concept of what is a channel type. So we have certain channel types which are gradiometers, magnetometers, EEG, MISC channels. You have all these types of channels which are specific, which allow you, for example, just to evoke.plot, you will know what are the channel types present in the data and do the splitting between the different channels. So I can do the same thing now for the magnetometers, for the gradiometers, and you see the auditory responses here very clearly in the magnetometers. And it's really matching what you would see here with the EEG that corresponds to a left dipole and a right dipole on both auditory cortices. All right, so now I want to show you that you can do interesting things in the Python ecosystem. So this is now just an interactive widget. So here I'm going to just move over time here, and you will see that it will move the topography. So this is really web-based technology, and it's really enabled by the Jupyter Python ecosystem. All right. So now I want to show you how to do, for example, cleaning. So I'm going to use certain ICA algorithm called Picard that Pierre Habla and my team developed. Here, I'm not going to rerun this because it's going to take a bit of time. But I'm just going to show you the result. This would be the ICA time course that you would obtain. So this is a certain time course, a certain source of ICA that clearly corresponds to a heartbeat. So this is the heartbeat topography on the magnetometers. And here, this is both evoke components. This is a nice dipolar field, also a nice dipolar field, and also here a secondary ECG component. And now, last but not least, I want to show you that you can do source imaging. So here, this is just plotting you a certain topo map at roughly 90 milliseconds post-stimulus. Here's the boundary element model that is useful to forward computation. And so once you have your forward operator, you can co-register your anatomy with the sensors. So here, what you see in blue is the MEG sensor. You have below in white the EEG sensors. And this, when you have all these things properly organized, you can do, for example, here a dipole fit at a given time point. So here I'm going to just do a dipole fit at 95 milliseconds. And I'm going to show you that you see a single dipole. So here you don't explain a lot of data because you would need two dipoles, one in the left auditory and one in the right auditory. But you do see that you get a good pickup of half of the data and give you an auditory dipole. All right, so last but not least, what I want to show you is that you can do machine learning with MNE. So here I'm going to do decoding. I'm going to try to classify between auditory right and auditory left stimulation. And here, so actually not auditory left versus auditory right, but visual versus auditory, which is a bit simpler. Here I'm going to use a logistic regression, do a cross-validation. So probably a lot of jargon if you're not familiar with decoding or machine learning. But you can see that here this problem is so simple that you get 100% accuracy if you use the entire data, the entire time window. But you can do something which is the decoding over time. So basically look at every time point if you can decode between auditory or visual stimuli, and you see that roughly in this after 100 milliseconds or between 100 and 200 milliseconds, it's really easy to differentiate between visual and auditory stimuli, and you see when you can actually decode your experimental conditions. All right, so this is it for the demo. I'd like to conclude very briefly by saying that if you need help using MNE, we have a mailing list. This is the best way to ask for help. So MNE analysis mailing list. And MNE is a work of many, many people. This is the name of the different people that have submitted code to MNE since the beginning. And this, I'd like to highlight the paper that we wrote in order to explain what MNE does and also allow us as researchers to get academic credit for the work we're doing with MNE. All right, thank you very much. And I'll be happy to answer questions if you have any. Thank you very much.